Good morning, everyone. We here from the post-graduation program of psychology at PUCRS. We are very proud to present Professor Dr. Maximiliano Wilson, who is an associate professor at the Speech-Language Pathology program, Faculty of Medicine, Université Laval in Quebec City, Canada. He's also a researcher at Cerveau Research Center. As a neuropsychologist, Dr. Wilson studies the effects of aging on language and specifically its effects on reading and understanding the meaning of words, known as semantics. Dr. Wilson combines behavioral studies with neuroimaging techniques to study how the brain processes language and its modification with age and under the effect of diseases such as progressive primary aphasia and Alzheimer's disease. So, fortunately, he's here to present us a conference entitled Improving Reading Comprehension in Adults with Developmental Dyslexia Using Morphological Awareness. So, please feel comfortable here with us. Very welcome, Professor Maximiliano, and we are here to listen and learn from you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you, Puki, for organizing this conference. I'm really happy to be here in spite of the cold weather we have today. So I'm going to present in English, but first of all, I'd like to say that I have a background in neuropsychology, and the things I'm going to present are related to language, but I strongly believe that language is also a matter of neuropsychology as well. So it's not only for speech therapy pathologists, but also for neuropsychologists and also educational psychologists. So in my vision, the things I'm going to present today could be perfectly well used and applied by any neuropsychologist who wants to improve reading abilities and reading comprehension in adults. So this is a very simple, we call it the simple view of reading, and it states that reading comprehension is form of two things. Actually, it's word decoding and linguistic comprehension. So the two together, comprehension and decoding, they help reading comprehension. But what is word decoding is the ability to transform print into spoken language. This means the ability of a person to see a printed letter and transform it into its corresponding sound. Okay, so this is like what we call word decoding, and you can also call it word naming in general, right? And then linguistic comprehension is the ability to understand language. It means activating meaning or semantics, taking into consideration the order of the words in a phrase, so the syntax, and also vocabulary. So it means the things a person knows, which are semantics, how they help us understand what the person is decoding, right? So the two together, word decoding and linguistic comprehension, they help reading comprehension. So this is called the simple view of reading, and I'm going to work this through the whole presentation. Word decoding allows to read new or unfamiliar words and texts, and word decoding also affects reading comprehension and vocabulary acquisition. So when people have word decoding difficulties, they also have reading comprehension difficulties. Individuals with dyslexia often have poor phonological representations and deviant phonological processing skills. So what we normally call dyslexic individuals, they have primarily problems with word decoding. So this means that they have difficulty to translate print into sound or written letters into spoken words, right? So this is the primary vision that we always had about dyslexia. So meaning that individuals with dyslexia, either children or adults, they have phonological abilities that are diminished as compared to normally developing people. So, but I will argue here that phonology is not the only thing that composes written words. There is also morphology, right? So we have phonemes and also morphemes. And I will argue here as well that explicit knowledge of both phonology and morphology will help children and adults decode the words, mostly the new words, right? So what I'm trying to say here is that this idea of having phonological problems is like the main view that we have, but lately we are paying more attention to other things that are morphology and morphological awareness. So not only phonological awareness, but also morphological awareness can help people understand what they're reading. So they also help reading comprehension. And even more so because morphemes also carry meaning. Unlike a phoneme that is only a sound and the minimal sound of the language, a morpheme also carries a meaning. So this means that this can also help even more understand or linguistic comprehension. But what is a morpheme? A morpheme is the smallest meaning-bearing unit, so it's the smallest meaningful unit that we can in which we can separate a word. And we combined morphemes to create new words or to change the meaning of a word. So, for instance, in the language of the place where I live, in Quebec, so we have French, and around 80% of the words of French have at least two morphemes. So this means that many, many words are morphologically complex, right? So as here, you have change, but you can say changement, changeable, changes, or unchangeable. So it means we combine morphemes to convey a different meaning for a sentence. So, and my point here is that knowing what this makes and how this changes the meaning of a word help people understand what they are reading, and mostly if it is a new word that they don't know. And also, knowledge about morphemes help people understand the inconsistencies of a language. So you know that we have a degree from very consistent languages as Spanish or Turkish or Finnish towards very inconsistent language as, languages as English or French, and Portuguese is somewhere in between. So it's not very consistent, but it's not as inconsistent as English. So I'm going to present here the two ends. I'm going to speak about Spanish and I'm going to speak about French, but you bear in mind that Portuguese should be somewhere in between. So you have in Portuguese some inconsistencies that do not follow rules, okay, and morphology will help that. For instance, in French we say hôpital for hospital, but we don't say hospitalisé to hospitalize, we say hospitalisé. So this means that there is an inconsistency in the morpheme, and knowing morphology will help people write or read these inconsistencies as well. I don't know, I don't think it happens in Portuguese, but in French we have two ways of writing the F sound. So either we can write it with F as fantaisie, or we can write it with PH as pharmacy. So also morphology help understanding this, because this means that these two words come from very different origins, etymologically speaking. So if people understand the morphemes that were carried out through time, they will also understand how to read it, how to write it, and also what it means, right? And problems in morphological process are also partly responsible for reading difficulties, mostly in children. So I already explained what morphology is, what a morpheme is, but now I'm going to explain what morphological awareness is. So, it's a metalinguistic ability, it's the conscious awareness of the morphemic structure words, and it's the ability to reflect on and manipulate morphemes. So, it means, as compared to phonological awareness, it's also metalinguistic, meaning that it's an ability over an ability. So, people should be able to manipulate voluntarily the morphemes in a word to understand what they mean, right? So, as a metalinguistic ability, it's also explored through metalinguistic tasks. So, normally we use sentence completion task or analogy task. For instance, we say children intelligent is to intelligent as obedient is to, and he has to complete the phrase with obedience, right? So, we make people explicitly use their morphological knowledge to complete, to do the task. So we always study morphological awareness, which is a metalinguistic ability or a metacognitive ability. We always explore it with metalinguistic or metacognitive tasks as well, right? So we force them to use what they know explicitly. So I told you about morphological awareness, I told you about word decoding, and I said that word decoding was part of reading comprehension. But what do we know about the relationship between morphological awareness and reading comprehension? A lot of the literature has focused on phonological awareness that might affect word decoding in children and how this affects reading comprehension. But very few studies have addressed the relationship between morphological awareness and reading comprehension. So what do we know about these three elements is that some studies showed that morphological awareness helped word decoding, and in time it helped people or children understand better what they were reading. Other studies have shown that morphological awareness had only a direct impact on reading comprehension, but no, it didn't affect word decoding. And other studies have shown that there were only through word decoding or morphological awareness, but only one study, to my knowledge, right, in English, explored all the possibilities together. So meaning whether morphological awareness affected word decoding and indirectly reading comprehension, and at the same time directly influence of morphological awareness towards reading comprehension. And this is a study by Ellen Deacon and colleagues. She's also Canadian. And what she did is she used a type of statistical analysis that we call path analysis. Briefly, it's structural equation analysis. And what we do is that we have theoretical models in mind. We know what literature has said about different components that might help or have an influence on the variable that is of interest. In our case, it's reading comprehension, so this is the variable of interest. And following this, with path analysis, we can create a model with all the arrows that will say this influenced this, this influenced that, and we know from different literature that the model could be combined like this, and we can test different models with different combinations. For instance, in red, you have here the two combinations, right? So morphological awareness will indirectly, via word decoding, affect reading comprehension, and directly as well. In this case, only indirectly, and in this model, only directly. So we can test all the models and see the model that best fit the data to choose it from path analysis. So path analysis allows us to test a direct or indirect direction, and also to compare theoretical models. So this is a very interesting way of doing things. And as you can see here, I don't know whether you can read it, here it says vocabulary, phonological awareness, and nonverbal abilities, right? So these other three abilities also have been shown to have an effect on reading comprehension. So a kid, the larger his vocabulary or her vocabulary, the better he will understand what he reads. The better, as I said before, the phonological awareness, the better he will understand what he reads. And nonverbal abilities measured, for instance, with the with Raven matrices, so which is nonverbal intelligence. So this also affects or helps reading comprehension. So in this model, these three variables are used to as control variables. So this means that beyond the effect of these variables, we want to test what we change in the model. So these three possibilities. And Deacon has done this. And what she found, using this in English, children, is that in English, when you test all three possibilities together, the model that best explains the data is the model that has both a direct and an indirect influence of morphological awareness on reading comprehension. So with one of my students who graduated last year, so we tried to do the same thing in Spanish. So we also used path analysis, and we had 125 fourth graders, so around 10 years of age, 10, 11 years of age. They were from Argentina. They were Spanish-speaking children. And so we tested exactly the same thing as Deacon did in English, but this time with Spanish-speaking children. So remember that Spanish is in the very consistent part of the continuum between orthography and phonology, whereas English was on the other side of the continuum. It was very inconsistent to transform letters into sounds. So we use different tests to test word decoding, we used a word and pseudo word reading test that we use in Spanish, that's standardized for Spanish. We used a morphological analogy task to test morphological awareness, as the one I showed you before, in which the kid has to complete the sequence using morphological awareness. And for reading comprehension, we also used a text comprehension from a standardized battery that we use in Argentinian Spanish. And for vocabulary, we use the Peabody test. I don't know whether you know it. So they have different pictures, and you name one of the objects, and they have to point to the picture. So you test if the kid knows what's the meaning of a word. For morphological awareness, we use another subtest of this Spanish, Argentinian, and Spain battery that's called phonemic segmentation. And for nonverbal abilities, we use the matrix reasoning subtest from the WISC-4. So these, again, these three were to control for the effects of those variables that we know that have an impact, but we were mostly interested in the relationship between the three things. So we also used path analysis, and so we put them together in this technique, all the variables together, and what we found in Spanish is that only, right, the direct connection between morphological awareness and reading comprehension affected reading comprehension. There was no influence, no indirect influence, as we found in English. This was the model retained in English, but the model that best fit the data in Spanish was a one that only had morphology towards reading comprehension. So the better your morphological awareness for a kid, the better his or her reading comprehension. And word decoding also has an effect on reading comprehension, but there is no effect of morphological awareness on word decoding in Spanish. And remember, we are talking about fourth graders, so 9.5 to 10.5 years of age, right? So why do we think that happens? English is a very transparent, it's a very opaque or very inconsistent orthography, whereas Spanish is very consistent. So this means that, I don't know what happens in Portuguese, we might discuss that afterwards, but children really fast, after the first year of formal education, so after the age of 6, they already master the correspondences, so they are able normally to read and decode. Remember that we had word decoding and linguistic comprehension. So for word decoding in Spanish, it's very easy for kids to master that. So very easily they can decode almost all of the words, except for some what we call contextual rules that I think we also have in Portuguese. So meaning that C after if you have CA, we pronounce it ca. If you have CE, we pronounce it se. So this is inconsistent, but it's contextual. So children might have problems with that before the first year of education, but really soon, really fast, they already mastered decoding. The problem is that doesn't mean that they will master as well reading comprehension. So they are really good at decoding, but that doesn't mean that they will understand really well as well. So we think that's the reason why children, 10-year-old children, morphological awareness helps reading comprehension, but it doesn't help word decoding in that case. So this is the difference between the two languages. And what happens in English? So this is what I just said, but what happens in English is that you need morphological awareness for word decoding, for instance. So can anyone pronounce this word? And this one? Dishwasher. Dishonor and dishwasher. So if a kid speaking English will apply the same rule, they would say dishonor and dishwasher, right? Or the other way around. Dishonor, dishwasher, right? But this means that the kid, in order to read in English, he still needs some morphological awareness, because otherwise he will generalize a rule that's not there. So this is a morpheme, and this is a morpheme, but they are different. So in this case, it's a compound. So dish is a word, washer is a word. A compound together means it's pronounced dishwasher. In this case, this means no, or the lack of honor. That's the morpheme, and honor means honor. So it's read dishonor, right? So kids in English, they still need to pay attention to those details in order to decode correctly a word. Otherwise, they will read dishonor, right? So in Spanish, we don't have that. It's so transparent for that children already, if they master the rules of conversion, they will be able to read even those compounds or morphologically complex words. So we think that this is the reason why we found those differences in English, where they still need morphology to help word decoding, to help transform these letters into words, a spoken word, and in Spanish we don't have that, right? But in any case, both in Spanish and in English, morphological awareness helps understand what a word means, right? So if the kid correctly spelled dishonor, it's very likely that he will know that it means that that's the lack of honor or a not honorable thing, right? So he will understand what that means. So morphology, it still helps in both languages to understand what they are reading. So we might, if we have time and you're willing to, we might discuss what might happen in Portuguese with this, right? Because we have English on one side, Spanish on the other side, but Portuguese, as I said, is in the middle of those things. So maybe we'll have both things, or we will find this pattern of results a bit later on, maybe for fifth graders or sixth graders in Portuguese. I don't know. So this was a study that we've done in Spanish in children to show you what morphological awareness is and how it might impact on the way people decode and the way people understand language. But I'm gonna transpose this into adults with developmental dyslexia. So my question was, if adults with developmental dyslexia can also benefit from morphological awareness. So I just showed you that, I hope you believe the data. It's still under review, so it might be published in a few months. So meaning that children are, the larger the morphological awareness, the better they understand, right? So the question is, what happens with adults that when they were kids, they were diagnosed with developmental dyslexia, and then they become adults who are university students? So pay attention to this detail. So this means that they could compensate really well their deficits, yes? So will they benefit from morphological awareness? So if we explicitly teach them how to use morphology in order to better understand and better decode words, will they benefit from that, or it's too late for them? So that's the study I'm going to present now, which is an intervention study. You know, dyslexia is a reading and writing disability. This means that the reading and writing skills of a person are significantly below the norms for age and education for the population. The prevalence of dyslexia in children is 4% according to the United Kingdom data, but it's more or less the same throughout the world. So it's around 4% of kids that have reading and writing disorders. There is an increasing number of university students, so we calculate that 1 to 1.5% of university students, they had reading and writing problems when they had it when they were kids, but they still have them as adults, right? And we have, I don't know whether this is the case in Brazil, but we have an increased number of university students in Canada and in other countries that have this dyslexia and dysgraphia problems, or reading and writing problems when they were kids. And the reason is that we have school accommodations. So this means that children, when they are diagnosed with reading problems or writing problems, they will have at school probably a person that will stay with them, like an assistant to the teacher that will stay with them and help them. They will also have more time to do tests, and they will have they will be allowed to use, for instance, computers and programs that will correct the way they write. So we have these accommodations as children grow up. So this means that more students arrive at university even though they had reading and writing problems when they were kids, right? So the interesting thing is that around 40% of the children, of the adults that are at university, they do not know that they have reading and writing problems. So this means they were not diagnosed when they were kids, and they thought they were only slow. They were really slow to understand what people were saying or what was written, but they were never diagnosed as having dyslexia or dysgraphia, right? So all this makes this a very compelling argument to develop something to help those people, right? Because they arrive at university and they find really difficult to keep up with the same rhythm and pace of everyone else. So what we see of those kids that are, those adults, sorry, that are not diagnosed or they don't know, because that's a crazy thing, but people, when they are adults, they forget what happened when they were kids. So maybe their parents took them to the neuropsychologist or a speech and language pathologist and they were diagnosed with reading and writing development. Then they were better because they worked hard, so the parents forgot about that and the kids forgot about that, and when they are adults, they think the problem is solved and they never had a problem or they don't have that any longer. The only thing, what we see, is that they have low self-esteem, a lot of anxiety problems because they have to study like three times more as other people. It takes them three times or four times more time to understand, to do the practical works and the things they have to do for university. So they just think they are slow, but this comes with anxiety of performance, low self-esteem, and academic difficulties. Those persons are also at risk of dropping off university because they won't be able to continue their studies, and they will just think it's because they are not as good as the others. While they had developmental dyslexia that's carried out into adulthood, and they had sometimes what comes also very often together, attentional difficulties. So we know already that phonological awareness deficits persist into adulthood. So if you had dyslexia when you were a kid, you might get better, you might get strategies to compose with that, but you still have those problems when you are an adult, right? And those kids that arrive at university, they really use really good strategies to compensate that, and those strategies might be using semantic knowledge, so vocabulary, as they increase vocabulary, that might help them to understand what they read. They can use visual memory, and I will talk about that as well, because we exploit that strategy in the intervention that I'm going to talk about later on, and they can use morphological knowledge to increase their reading comprehension at university. So these are three of the strategies that those adults, university students, might use to compensate for their developmental problems. And we also know that morphological awareness, as I said before, contributes to the successful reading and spelling compensation in adults with developmental dyslexia. So if we focus on, I named three strategies, one of those, which is morphological awareness, is really important for adults to compensate the reading problems, right? There's a study by a colleague, and they found that compensated dyslexics perform significantly better on morphological awareness tasks as compared to non-compensated adults dyslexics. And their morphological awareness might even be comparable to that of normally developing readers as they are adults. So this means that if they manage to increase their morphological awareness, they might perform better than their colleagues that have dyslexia but do not have this compensatory mechanism. So this morphological awareness is really important for adults to compensate for reading comprehension problems. So we decided to develop at university a morphological awareness intervention to improve the comprehension in those students that we have at university. And I have to a disclosure here, and I will say that the last, we really have a financial support and a very important support from our university because they were concerned about these students. So we got a lot of help from them to develop this type of intervention, and I hope I will convince you that it works, actually. So we had only 19 undergraduates because we had many that started, but not many finished the intervention. That's why we thought at the very beginning to make a short intervention. So we'll see there's only three sessions. So it means 3 weeks. They have to come once a week. So it's only three sessions. But even so, they always say, no, we have tests now, it's exam period, and so there's a lot of them, almost like, I'd say like 40% drop out of the study when they started. So we had many more, but only 19 finished. So as you can see, they were undergraduate, So I think this means in Portuguese for formatura students, and we had four from master's studies, and they all had a diagnosis of developmental dyslexia, and six of them had also a diagnosis of attentional deficit. As I said, they come all the time or very often together. So as you can see, they're working. This is a Z score. So I wrote here minus 1.5 Z score, right? So this means in neuropsychology, we usually use this Z score to say what goes below 1.5 Z score is not normal processing. So this means that all, even in the low part of the continuum, they had normal working memory, they had normal vocabulary, and they had normal nonverbal reasoning, these kids, right? So they had reading and sometimes writing problems, but they had other cognitive abilities that were preserved, comparable to other normally developed adults. So we made a really long assessment before the intervention and after the intervention. So we used to we test receptive abilities, phonological awareness, morphological awareness, word recognition, and which is a lexical decision task. Basically, so we present words mixed with invented words, and they have to say whether they know the word or it's invented. And we also had spelling recognition. So is the word well written or it's a spelling mistake? So, and we also had productive abilities. We tested text comprehension, verbal fluency, word and all one reading, so this is word decoding for us, text writing, and word spelling. So we tested, we had a comprehensive neuropsychological battery, so we tested other cognitive functions, but what I'm presenting here is the part that focuses on language processing. And the intervention itself, so as I said, we had a pre-test assessment, a post-test assessment. We had three intervention sessions. They were about, I think, 2 hours each. I will say it in the following slide. And they also had individual daily training because we gave them homework that they had to do from day one to day seven that they had the second session of intervention. And then we corrected that and we gave them feedback on what they had at home. And then we had the second session, and then we gave them homework for every single day of the things between session two and three, and the same thing between session three and the post-test. So we gave them homework and we gave them the keys, so the answers to the exercises they were doing, so they got that as well. So sessions, there were group sessions, we had three. They were 2 hours each, so it makes 6 hours of intervention. And homework, they had activities, they had the exercises and the keys, so the replies, the correct answers, for a total of 7 hours. So we asked them to do a 30-minute practice every day for 14 days. So this means between the sessions. So this part was the part that made some people discourage and leave the intervention because they said they didn't have those 30 minutes every day to do that. But those, you will see that those who actually did that, they really improved. And what are the session contents? I can discuss this, I can present you more details about every single session details. But basically, they had explanations about the cognitive mechanisms of reading and writing. So we do psychoeducation, so we taught them how people read, how dyslexic people might read, so what are the difficulties, what are the challenges people might face when they have dyslexia, and we talk to them about anxiety problems and working memory, probably difficulties or attentional deficits that they might have. So we explained them, we gave them the whole picture of their reading and writing profiles, and they received explicit training in the French phoneme and grapheme system. So we re-explained what they acquired like implicitly at school. So we taught them, I will show you, how many phonemes are in French, so what are the correspondences between a letter and its possible phonemes. Well, you know, as I told you, French is close to English in the inconsistency, so sometimes you have up to six ways of writing the phoneme O. So you can write it six different ways. So they need to know that when they find that written, it's always pronounced O. So we taught them that explicitly again, those inconsistencies of the French language. We also taught them explicitly about derivational and flexional morphology, and we put the stress on accordance, meaning that when you have a sentence, if it's plural, it should go plural with the adjective. If it's female, it should go female with the adjective. If it's the third person singular, so the verb should follow the person. So we made the emphasis, we put the emphasis on that. And we also taught them something that's really interesting. Remember I told you that one of the strategies that adults with dyslexia used to compensate for the deficit is visual memory. So we taught them explicitly how to remember how words might be written, and this is something that a French researcher developed, and it's called illustrated spelling method. I will show you what that is. And so we gave them the program at home with exercise and practice, and they had also practice during the 2-hour session. So we explained something, and we had a 2 or 3 minute exercise, and then we corrected all together, and they got feedback on that, and then they had the activities they could do at home as well. So this is the phonemic chart of French. So for someone that's not French speaking as myself, that's a problem, because in Spanish we only have 5 vowels, 5, right? A, E, I, O, U, and in French we have 16 vowels. So it's really difficult, and that's the reason why we also have these inconsistencies, because when they spoke French after the, that's a historical note, after the Roman Empire ceased to exist, all our languages, Portuguese, Spanish, French, started to develop more separated from the Latin, but then when they wanted, and the Latin remained like the formal language of culture, books, and exchange, but then they wanted to start writing in their own language that had evolved very separately from Latin, and they went back to the same alphabet as Latin, and as you know, they only had 5 vowels in Latin. So they had to combine letters, as I think we do as sometimes in Portuguese, to be able to express all those in French, 16 vowels with only 5 vowels. So there's a combination of vowels, of letters, of ways of writing that will represent those 16 vowels. And that's why French is very inconsistent. And we also taught, this is the illustrated spelling method. So because of etymological reasons, some words have, for instance, double consonants, but unlike Italian, right, you don't pronounce. In Italian, you pronounce every single consonant. So Italian is absolutely transparent for reading and absolutely transparent for writing. So if you spell something to an Italian person, they won't get that wrong, because you pronounce every single letter. So if there's a double letter, you pronounce it double, so they will know how to write it. And they wisely, in my opinion, historically, they took out all the H at the beginning of words, only for 1 or 2 words, so there's no inconsistency. So you hear something and you can write it almost perfectly well. But in French, we have that as well, but you don't pronounce it, so you don't say accord, you say accord. But they should remember that it's written with 2 C's, even though we pronounce only 1. So this spelling, illustrated spelling method is very interesting for people that have these visual memory abilities, because you tell them, try and imagine, picture something related to the meaning of the word, and just think, so this means like understanding, right? So that's why you have the 2 hands, one coming out every from one of the 2 C's, just to remember that this is written with 2 C's. Or in French, I don't know whether you can see it, you also have it in Portuguese, the circumflex accent. So age, age in English, is written with this accent. So this means age, so they can picture an elderly person with the mustache here, just to remember how it's written. So we explicitly taught them how to exploit this capacity to understand and to remember how to write and picture the words they were saying. And then finally, so we also explicitly taught them the regularities of morphology in French as we have them in Portuguese and as we have them in Spanish. For instance, the ear, we told them, this is a suffix, this is a root, this is a prefix, and the suffix ER in English mostly denotes a person or a thing that does this activity, dancer, footballer, player, teacher. So every time you have that, it's written all the time, every time the same way, and it also has the same meaning. So we taught them explicitly morphology. So this was the intervention, 3 sessions, so 6 hours in total. And how about the results? So if you see word decoding or word reading, right, it significantly improved from pre-test in blue to post-test in yellow. So they were better at decoding words in French when we test them before the intervention and after the intervention. So if I put the asterisk, this means that this is statistically significant. And how about morphological awareness? That was the ability that was explicitly taught. We used a task that was to find the intruders. For instance, they had 3 words, incapable, invisible, insect, and they had to say which one, because sometimes, as we taught them, sometimes you have the same letter sequence, but this is not a morpheme, it's only part of the word. So they had to identify that the in insect was not a morpheme, so it didn't belong to the family. So this was a very morphological awareness task, because they had to use what they knew about the language, morphology, in order to do the task. And so also they improved, so it was a 16-item task. So you see that they significantly improved before and after the intervention. And what's interesting, I find, is that there was no difference in time, because it was a time task, right? So they used a comparable time to do the task before and after the training. So what we see there, if they use the same time, it means that they apply different strategies within the same time to do it. I think this is very interesting, because this means that we are not making them faster, we are just making them better at understanding what they're doing, which is the point. And the thing is, we didn't get any significant results in spelling. So for writing, even though we explicitly taught how to use these imaging techniques, they were as good or as bad as they were before the intervention. So they only improved in morphology, decoding, and I will show you afterwards, reading comprehension. But the thing is, as you might already know, when we do clinical stuff, patients are very different from each other. There is a lot of heterogeneity. So if I show you here, as I told you, morphological awareness, there is it's significant, the difference if we put the whole group together. But if I show you here the picture of some of the students that we had in Z score, remember that 0 means no change. This means that it was a positive change. They got better after the treatment, and this means that they had a negative result, which is puzzling. And so we had some students that got worse on individual basis after in the post-test as compared to the pre-test. And the most interesting results, I think, is that we focused on morphological awareness. The idea was to see whether this improved the reading comprehension of texts of those university students, and what we found is that they improve reading comprehension. So they were better comprehenders after the intervention than before. And also what they all said is that they actually felt that they had better tools to deal with written works and reading articles at university. So this means that they felt actually better. You know, when you do a scale, so they actually felt that subjectively they were better tooled to deal with those problems. And if you see here, so we had time and we had the score for reading comprehension. So they got, again, so these are Z scores, so in this case the mean is positive, so they got better and they were faster at reading comprehension. But again, if I show you the picture here, there's a very heterogeneous result for each patient. So here, again, in red you had the score change, and in yellow the time change for reading comprehension before and after the intervention. So you see there's a very heterogeneous result here, but most of them improved. And what's interesting, in my opinion, is that some people, they are actually slower, but they are better at comprehending. So this is a good thing, because it means that they pay more attention and they take more time to try to comprehend what they are reading, but they are better, so they arrive at better results. So this is good, because we think that the intervention gave them a strategy to better deal with those difficulties, even though this means they're going to be slower, but they're going to be better at doing that. So, to end, to conclude, as you can see, and I hope you believe in the data, as I told you, these are under, we're still writing it. So young adults with developmental dyslexia improve their phonological awareness abilities, and they also improve their reading comprehension. So we focused on morphological awareness, and it helped them become better comprehenders. So we gave them a lot of tools that they can use. And the good thing about adults is that you can do it explicitly. With children, you cannot teach them all the correspondences and how to write, but with adults, you can actually tell them. So if you do this like this, and if you use this strategy, you're going to get better, and they will use it explicitly because they are able to get strategies explicitly. And so these results further highlight what I showed you with the first study in Spanish, that there is a relationship between morphological awareness and reading comprehension, right? So the better you are, the better your morphological awareness is, the better normally you comprehend what you are reading. So we don't know what happens, and I'm curious to know your input about what might happen in Portuguese with this, and what happens in Portuguese with this relationship between morphological awareness and word decoding, and morphological awareness and reading comprehension. Because as I told you, in English, morphological awareness impacts word decoding. It helps children read better, and it helps children understand better. But in Spanish, that's on the other side of the continuum, which is a very consistent language. At the age of 10, children with good morphological awareness abilities only get better at comprehending, but not at decoding, because they are already very good at that. So I'd like to hear your input on what happens in Portuguese. And as I told you, to end with this, this intervention is focused on language, but I will argue again, as I did at the beginning, that language is part of cognitive function. So any neuropsychologist, any speech language pathologist, or any educational psychologist might be able to use this kind of intervention that focuses on languages, but it helps other abilities like reading comprehension. And reading comprehension is not only language, but it's many other cognitive functions. So this is something that a neuropsychologist might use in their everyday clinical practice. So, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Maximiliano Wilson. Thank you, Irani Arjimon, as well as our coordinator of the postgraduate program at our university, and all present people here. So, I'm here to help everyone to organize our questions, if you have questions, and if you don't, I have some here. Because I got curious about some parts of your data. So does anyone have any question? Okay, very good. So Osana, please.
Posso perguntar em português?
And translate.
Max, antes eu queria ver se o diagnóstico desses adultos disléxicos ele foi feito na adultez ou se eram pessoas que vocês já conheciam ou que tinham algum diagnóstico prévio de dislexia na infância.
I'm going to translate.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Ozana just asked if these dyslexic adults were diagnosed when they were children, so developmental dyslexia, or if they were lately diagnosed as adults already.
Yeah. So, the criterion we use to get those students is that they already need to have a diagnosis of dyslexia when they were children. So all of them, because this was like a pilot study, wanted to see whether it worked. So we wanted kids that already had, when they were kids, this thing. So how it works at our university, at Laval University, is that the children that go to the center of student aid, they will go there and say, okay, I was diagnosed with attentional deficit. I was diagnosed with reading problems. So they will bring the doctor's certificate, or the speech language therapist, or the neuropsychologist's certificate saying that they have this problem, and they will give them the accommodations I mentioned. So they will have more time, they will be able to use like computer that will and computer programs that will correct the way they write. So if they get that wrong, it will say, okay, no, this is not well written, try in a different way. So, and they will have more time for testing, and they will be tested in separate rooms alone. So these are all the accommodations that they will have. So there is a list of students, and we ask our colleagues from the center of...
Dificuldade na primeira avaliação tinha déficit. Eu vi que eles melhoraram, mas eles já tinham déficit na avaliação inicial.
In the pre-post assessment, in the pre-test assessment, is all the dyslexic patients were with difficulties in reading comprehension?
That's a really good question, and the answer is not all of them were below normal. They were normally in the lower range of normal reading comprehension capacities, but the thing is, they were really well performers, because they arrived at university, they were studying, so they were in the low part of reading comprehension, but not all of them had problems. And the, and what's interesting also is that the what adds to the heterogeneity of these profiles is that sometimes when they were kids and they had reading and writing problems, and when they are adults, they will do careers that will not ask them to write or read a lot, like engineer or what we call woods. We have a whole career of to work in the forest. So they will do those things that will be more, they will not ask them to write, they will not go to become lawyers or to become linguists, because they will have to read a lot and to write a lot. So normally they go to those professions. So that helps them perform better as well at university.
It will be like a functional compensation.
Yeah.
The choice of career, very interesting. I think there was another question of yours.
Yeah. Can I ask in Spanish?
No, I translate to English, okay? Yeah.
Eu queria perguntar, era a mesma pergunta, assim, como eles chamaram os participantes, né?
Uh-huh.
Mas agora que ele já respondeu, como aplicar isso nas escolas, assim, como usar todos esses dados, how to use these data in school?
I don't need to translate anymore, you already finished the question in English.
I think I'm not quite sure that this can be applied with really young kids, because if they are 10 or 11, it's very difficult, because as I told you, it's a very explicit strategy. So we teach them how to use all the tools that they have to understand the language and to process the language. So I think it could be used with kids that already have like executive functions developed, like I'd say like 12-year-olds and older. So I don't think it could be used with really young kids, and it could be used in secondary schools, for instance, because it's the good thing about this is that when they are teenagers, they can already use strategies, so you can teach them explicitly, so that's one thing. And the second thing is that it's a very simple thing, because it's a group intervention, so you can have like 10 students all together, you can give them these tools, and then you can see whether you apply them or not. But this is only an idea, because we haven't tested this in younger people, right?
Can I add some info? There is a school neuropsychologist called Meltzer. She published lots of books and some scientific evidence about teaching explicit strategies, even linguistic ones and metalinguistic ones, to children. So since 9 years old in USA, children with more sessions than you did, because they need more explicit strategies, they can make benefits of these strategies, getting a better reading comprehension and text production. So, and executive functions strategies as well. So I think for Brazilian population, it would be very beneficial. Yeah.
So thank you very much for being here early in a cold morning.
So let's clap another turn, because Maximiliano Wilson deserves. No more questions, yeah?